Thank you and welcome. I appreciate you guys being here to spend your Monday evening with me. I also am grateful to Dr. Marks and Dr. Stearns for the opportunity to talk with you about the science of diversity at work. I have three goals for the talk this evening. First is to make this work. The first is that I would really like to share with you what I think are some important findings from our research related to diversity at work. I'm going to be talking about my own research as well as that of other influential scholars in the field. I also want to offer you some science-based solutions. I don't want to only tell you about problems, I also want you to know some strategies for overcoming them. Finally, I hope to ignite your interest in organizational psychology and social science more broadly. I hope you walk out of here thinking, damn, that social science stuff is cool. So that's a big task, and I'd like to begin with a brief activity. I'm going to ask you to watch a brief video. In this video, you will see people passing a basketball back and forth. I'm going to ask you to focus very closely on the individuals wearing white, and I want you to count the number of times they pass the ball back and forth, okay? So count the number of times the ball passes between individuals wearing white. Okay, how many of you out there counted 5 or more passes? Okay, how many of you counted 10 or more? Okay, how many of you saw something a little strange in the middle? Okay, I saw some hands, but for those of you who didn't raise your hand, let me give you one more shot. This time, don't worry about counting. Do you see it now? This is a phenomenon called inattentional blindness. The idea here is sometimes we're paying such close attention to one thing that we totally miss something else. And it turns out the researchers on this topic, they're cognitive psychologists, they have found that as much as 50% of the population misses the gorilla in this video. But if you saw the gorilla, don't pat yourself on the back too quickly, because people who see the gorilla often perform worse on the task. So why did I show you this? I want to get you to start to think about the gorillas that you might be missing. And indeed, I'm going to argue that sometimes gorillas are prevalent when people from diverse backgrounds interact in the context of the workplace. So I want to tell you a little bit about that workplace. What does it look like? You may have heard that the minority populations in this country are increasing. In fact, according to the latest census data, only about 60 to 63% of Americans identify themselves as white or Caucasian. Instead, what we've seen in the past 10 years is substantial growth among Hispanic, Latino populations, as well as Asian populations. Diversity goes beyond ethnicity, though. We also see substantial diversity when it comes to age. You might have heard of the graying of the workplace. Because people are living longer and needing money longer in their lives, people are waiting till longer later to retire. And in fact, today there are up to 4 different generations represented in the workplace for the first time ever in history. Clearly, age diversity is also an aspect of the workplace. Finally, there's aspects of diversity that are less observable, they're not readily apparent. One example of this is religious diversity. You can see from this graph that about 50% of the population identifies as Protestant, but a large proportion also identifies as Catholic. And in that funny color up at the top left, that's actually people who said they were nothing. So about 16% of the population, according to the Pew Foundation, actually says they don't have any religion. So certainly there are differences here that we might not always see on first glance. Why is this important? It's important because people from all these different backgrounds are bringing baggage with them when they go to work. As soon as you walk in that door, you're bringing things with you. And I'm going to talk about 2 things in particular. The first, stereotypes. The second, prejudice. Research on stereotypes, which represent generalizations about your beliefs about a group of people, has shown that they can be classified along two primary dimensions. The first is warmth, and the second is competence. The idea here is that any stereotyped group you can imagine can be classified along this space. This is work by Susan Fiske, and she has found that working dads, for example, are seen as high in warmth but low in and also high in competence, whereas the elderly and stay-at-home moms are seen as high in warmth but lacking competence. Asians and Muslims are stereotyped as being highly competent but lacking warmth, and people who are low in both categories include the homeless and obese. These beliefs are important, and in fact, there is evidence that these beliefs carry across national boundaries. Some of Susan Fiske's work has been done in over 20 different countries, and so she has actually found that no matter what country you're talking about, when you're talking about groups within that country that are stereotyped, they can be classified along this two-dimensional space. And indeed, this space is important because these beliefs are associated with attitudes about these groups. So for working dads, for example, who are seen as high in warmth and competence, we tend to feel some pride when we think about those groups. This can be contrasted with envy, a more negative emotion that we experience when we think about Asians or Muslims, and pity when we think about stay-at-home moms or the elderly, and finally disgust when we think about homeless people or people who are obese. Some really interesting data on the implications of these differences comes from some neuroimaging studies. They have found that, let's see if I can get this to work. Yes. When participants in a study who were placed in a scanning machine which tracked the activity in their brain, what they found was that showing pictures of people in each of these three groups, the highly warm but low competence, high in both, and high in competence and low in warmth, showing pictures of people in these three groups evoked a particular response in the brain, which is similar to showing pictures of any body. In other words, the part of the brain that lights up when people think about people lit up when they thought about people in these three groups. However, that part of the brain, the prefrontal medial cortex, did not light up at all. It was not activated when people thought about homeless people or obese people. What that means is that some people's brains, on average, people's brains, don't even register people in this category as people. And to me, that was a pretty scary finding, but you might be wondering, how much of a problem is this? So our brains don't light up, what does that really mean? So I want to ask you for a moment to consider, how biased do you think your coworkers are? Where would you put them on this 1 to 10 scale on average? Would you put them around a 5, around a 6? How much bias do you think they have from not a lot to a lot? Have a number in your mind. Okay, now I want you to ask the same question about yourself. Where do you go on this scale? Where do you fall? Are you a 1? Are you a 4? Are you a 10? Okay, how many of you said that you are less biased, your number is lower than your colleagues? I did. I think I'm way less biased than my colleagues. I know some of you are out there. It turns out we all think that. We all have blind spots to our own biases. Of course, we can't all be better than average, right? So statistically speaking, it's impossible for this effect to be true. We can't all be less biased than everybody else. So we actually have a blind spot to our own biases that can interfere with our interactions and the way that we approach work. This is one of those gorillas that we might be missing. And I would also argue that not only because of these blind spots, but also because stereotypes can lead to behavior, these are the reasons that we should be concerned about these sorts of things. So research on this topic again has shown that these emotional reactions can lead to specific patterns of behavior. So when we interact with someone who we see who evokes pride, like a working dad, we want to cooperate and affiliate with them. Whereas if we're interacting with someone like a stay-at-home mom or an elderly person who evokes pity, then we want to help them. That's the behavioral response that we experience. I want to tell you a little bit more about some other behaviors that research has found to be associated with stereotypes. In one study, John Barge and his colleagues presented participants with words like old, elderly, and aging. The trick in this study, however, was that these were presented so quickly that participants didn't even know that they were being presented this information. It was presented outside of their conscious awareness on a computer screen when they were busy with some other task. So they didn't even know that these words were being primed in their minds. Nevertheless, John Barge and his colleagues found that when participants were exposed to these words, they actually moved more slowly throughout the rest of the experiment. So outside of their conscious awareness, people were being primed with stereotypes that unconsciously affected their behavior. Here again, you may be thinking, well, that's interesting, but what do I really do with that? You know, how does that really affect behavior in the real world? You're talking about brains, you're talking about labs. What about the real world? And that is exactly the question that some of my students and colleagues and I have been examining. We want to understand how stereotypes affect behavior in the workplace. And to demonstrate, I'd like to introduce you to Afra. Afra is a former George Mason undergrad who is now a doctoral student in our program. And in this study that we conducted together with several other students, Afra applied for jobs. She applied for jobs in retail stores. She carried a tape recorder hidden, which is legal in Virginia. She also followed a script, very detailed script, so she would behave the same way in each interaction. And she made observations after each job application. So she filled out a questionnaire after each job application. And what we wanted to know, based on Afra's experience, was how she was treated when she appeared in this condition compared to this one. You can see the difference here is that in one condition, she's wearing a hijab and abaya that makes her appear to be Muslim. And confirming our expectations, we found that Afra received more negative interpersonal treatment when she applied for jobs wearing a hijab and abaya than when she did not wear that hijab and abaya, when she did not appear to be Muslim. What do I mean by negative interpersonal treatment? I'll ask you to think for a moment about someone you don't like very much. Everybody has somebody they don't like very much. So think about what you do when you're with them. You probably don't look them in the eye, right? Because you avoid eye contact. You probably try to like walk away from them, like do the like slide backwards. You probably act unfriendly, maybe a little rude, maybe a little hostile. Those are the sorts of behaviors that Afra experienced when she was applying for a job. We found a very similar pattern of results when Whitney looked to see the kind of experience she might have in those same kinds of stores. Whitney either appeared as her average weight self or in wearing an obesity prosthesis. Here too, Whitney was treated much more negatively when she wore the prosthesis than when she did not. Finally, we were also interested in whether these behaviors could extend to women who are pregnant. We thought maybe there would be hostility towards women who are pregnant and applying for jobs. So here too, we had an undergraduate, here is Amber, wear a pregnancy prosthesis this time that made her appear to be pregnant. And again, what we found was that when Amber applied for jobs wearing the pregnancy prosthesis, she was treated more negatively than when she was not wearing the pregnancy prosthesis. However, we thought something might be a little bit different in the case of pregnancy. Because when you think of someone who's pregnant, they are actually fulfilling the ideals of womanhood, and they're sort of a bastion of femininity, and you know, because they are becoming a mother, this is the ideal. And so in some sense, there may be a positive reaction to women in these sorts of situations. However, we thought that that sort of femininity would need to be congruent with the situation. So in this case, we looked not only at how Amber was treated when she applied for jobs in retail stores, but also how she was treated when she just asked for help looking for a gift for her sister. Asking for help is much more consistent with the feminine gender role than applying for a job. And so what we actually found was that While Amber got the negative treatment when she was applying for a job, she actually got overly positive treatment when she was asking for help. And what do I mean by overly positive feedback? People called her sweetie and honey, and they said, oh, let me help you with this. Take a load off. You should relax. Sit. They actually made her sit sometimes. They tried to touch her belly. They got in her personal space, and it was, you know, not real, so that was a little uncomfortable. So you can imagine that these sorts of behaviors can serve as interpersonal punishments and rewards. On the one hand, women are being punished when they engage in less feminine behaviors by applying for jobs, but they also get these sort of interpersonal rewards when they're asking for help. What this confirms is a theory about benevolent sexism. Benevolent sexism is a type of prejudice that seems kind or benign in nature. It's the idea that women should be cherished and protected because they are our mothers and they are the mothers of our children. And so we put them on a pedestal and we try to protect them from harm. We wanted to understand whether that same belief system would influence other behaviors in the workplace outside of a job application context. So in a series of studies, we examined what are called developmental work experiences. Developmental work experiences are those stretch assignments that make you sort of work extra hard and learn something new. Most of the time, developmental experiences are necessary for you to actually gain the skills that will help you to get a promotion and, in fact, succeed in a higher level in your organization. We found that across several studies, women reported experiencing less access to those challenging developmental assignments than did men. And we also found that women said they wanted them as much. So it's not that women didn't want these assignments. Instead, what it seems is that decision makers who endorse these benevolent ideologies that women should be protected didn't want to make them stretch too far. For example, you might think of the case where a supervisor is making a decision about a developmental opportunity that requires travel. And there may be an assumption that a woman might not want that opportunity because she might want to stay with her family. That's a missed opportunity for that woman that may be associated with this benevolent sexism I've been talking about. So I hope I've convinced you at this point that there are behavioral outcomes of stereotypes and prejudice in the workplace. But you might still be thinking, so what? These seem pretty subtle, and they are. This is subtle stuff I'm talking about. And really, if you compare it to what people experienced 50 years ago, wow, I mean, isn't that some genuine progress? We've really shifted from these covert kinds of discrimination to these very, overt kinds of discrimination to these very subtle or covert kinds of discrimination. And yes, that's one view. You might think of that as genuine progress. However, some of our research suggests that this subtle stuff may be particularly problematic. It's difficult to identify, assess, and eradicate. And it turns out there are extreme consequences for targets and the organizations they work for that I'm going to tell you about next. Targets who experience discrimination, even this subtle stuff, also tend to report higher levels of stress and lower levels of satisfaction with their job and their life, right? So you're less satisfied with your life as a whole, and it can worsen your mental and physical health. So there are real implications for targets. There are also some real implications for organizations. When discrimination is reported in an organization, it's likely associated with employees who don't want to work there very much. Our field surveys have suggested that people who experience discrimination or work in organizations in which discrimination has occurred, they want to leave, right? And so that can be costly to an organization. It can also lead to an underutilization of human capital. If you're hiring people on the basis of how they look rather than how they perform their jobs, then you're not going to be hiring the people who would perform those jobs the best. You might also face some litigation, which can be time-consuming and costly. And I want to talk especially about some potential performance implications. What happens to people's performance on the job when they experience discrimination? Some research by Claude Steele and many others has focused on a phenomenon called stereotype threat. Stereotype threat occurs when a person is aware of a stereotype of members of their group, and then they behave in ways that eventually confirm it. As an example, women are aware that there's a stereotype that women are not as good at math compared to men. And unfortunately, when women are given a math test and told that it is a test that is diagnostic of their math ability, they actually perform worse on that test than they would the exact same test that was just called a test. So the name of the test, math diagnostic tool versus a test, actually changes the way that women perform on that test. I also want to talk to you about how negative treatment itself can lead to some performance implications. We have studied this in our lab, and to do so, we used a training paradigm. You might have, at some point in your life, had to go to training, and in that training, your organization was probably trying to get you to learn something new to help you do your job better. However, we hypothesized that when trainees have social identity characteristics that are associated with negative stereotypes, they might actually not get the same kind of training as people who do not have negative social identity characteristics. In other words, discrimination may manifest in training interactions. So what we wanted to do was find out if that is indeed the case. And we brought undergraduates into the lab, and we assigned one of them to the role of an instructor or trainer. And that person mastered the task at hand. It was a computer task. And they viewed a photograph of the person who they were supposed to be training. And that photograph was either someone pictured as average weight or someone in that obesity prosthesis. So the instructor, the trainer, thought that they were training someone who was either average weight or obese. And after they saw that photograph, they actually provided training to that person via the talk feature of Instant Messenger. And they never saw the person face to face, but they talked to them over the internet. The trainee, the learner here, received the training and then performed the task. We wanted to see, would their performance on this task vary? And what we found was that, confirming our expectations, instructors thought that learners who were pictured as obese would perform worse on this task. So there was low expectations of the ostensibly obese trainees. And they actually provided worse training to the individuals who they thought were obese. And ultimately, those same individuals who were thought to be obese performed worse on that task. So being treated in this negative way, being provided poorer training, ultimately resulted in lower training outcomes. And if you take it a step further, you might think about the implications of this. If you're not learning what you need to learn in training to do your job, well, then your performance evaluations are going to be decreased, and then you're not going to get the promotion, and you can sort of play it out over time. I also wanted to mention that one of my current students, Tracy McCausland, is doing a similar study. She just finished up collecting data where she was interested in looking at older and younger employees and whether these same patterns might emerge when people think they're training someone who's older as opposed to training someone who is younger. And her initial results basically confirm the same pattern. People have lower expectations of trainees who are older than they do of trainees who are younger, and that can actually influence their performance on this task. So I argue here again, discrimination has real consequences in the form of performance decrements. So then the question becomes, I hope I've convinced you that there are important outcomes here that we should be talking about. So the question then becomes, and I promised you I would tell you, what can targets and allies do about this? I should mention that there are also other things organizations can do. There's a lot of things organizations can do, but I want to focus on you as individuals, what you as a target or you as an ally might do to reduce the discrimination that occurs. And the first thing I want to say is that targets have the opportunity to individuate. Individuation is a process by which targets might separate or distinguish themselves from the stereotypes about members of their group. By directly addressing a stereotype and providing contradictory information, targets might be able to reduce the discrimination they encounter. To show you an example of this, I'm going to go back to Afra. And in this study, we not only compared how Afra was treated when she wore the hijab and abaya compared to when she did not, but also how she was treated depending on the type of language that she used to describe herself. In half of the conditions, Afra mentioned that she was a volunteer. This was designed to address the stereotype that Muslims are perceived to be low in warmth. By discussing a volunteer opportunity, Afra was directly individuating herself from that stereotype and providing contradictory information. And what we found was Afra actually received less negative behavior, less negative interpersonal treatment, less discrimination when she claimed to be volunteering than when she did not. So this is an example of individuation. As another example, we wondered whether the same thing could apply to the case of obesity. So here you'll see Whitney in the obesity prosthesis. And in half of the conditions in that study, Whitney individuated herself from the stereotype of obese people as lazy by specifically stating she was on a diet and she was training for a half marathon. She even brought with her a Diet Coke. And here too, what we found was that when she discussed these counter-stereotypic characteristics, she actually experienced less negative interpersonal treatment, less discrimination. So this is evidence that targets can individuate themselves from stereotypes about them. Before I talk about what allies can do, I want to mention that I wouldn't endorse the idea that targets should be responsible for the burden of reducing the discrimination they encounter. Rather, I wanted to talk about this as a way of empowering targets. But I will go on to say what allies can do, which the first thing is to think about chocolate cake. Sounds a little outrageous, I know. Now you're really gonna think about it. If you're like me, when there's a piece of chocolate cake in your refrigerator, it calls out to you. It says, Eden, I'm delicious. And I try very, very hard not to think about it. But what happens? What's the first thing I think about? The chocolate cake. Right, exactly. So this is an example of what psychologists call the ironic effects of thought suppression. When we try to reduce our thoughts about something, when we tell ourselves not to think about it, we actually end up thinking about it more and you eat the whole slice of cake. This is relevant because researchers have found that similar patterns exist when you're talking about things like race. So in a study by Jennifer Richeson, she compared the discrimination that people engaged in depending on whether they were first told not to think about race versus when they were told it's okay to think about race. So she called this identity blind versus identity conscious conditions. Either don't think about the characteristics of the job applicants you are evaluating, or you can think about them, but just try to be fair. What she found was that there was less bias in the identity conscious condition. So people who were allowed to think about race actually treated people more fairly than people who were trying not to think about it. And the argument here is that just like with the chocolate cake, those thoughts can intrude and influence our decisions. Another thing that allies can do, in addition to thinking about chocolate cake, is to fight conformity. Conformity is a very, very strong social tool. I want to tell you about some of the original research on this topic. This is a laboratory. The experimenter here is Solomon Ash, and he asked students to come into the lab and sit around a table, and he wanted to know whether people would go along with what everybody else was doing even when they knew it was wrong. So he devised a situation where it was a very clear right and wrong answer. Here you can see the exhibits that he presented participants. Participants were asked to indicate which of the lines in exhibit 2 on the right-hand side were the same length as the line on the left-hand side, exhibit 1. And clearly there's a correct answer, it's A. But in the study that Solomon Ash conducted, everybody said B. That's because they were all not true participants, but actual experimenters. That is, except for one poor soul, this guy in the middle here, who was the true participant. Everyone else at that table was in on it. And that's why they all said, well, clearly it's line B. And this poor guy is looking at it thinking, how can they say that? Clearly it's wrong. Clearly it's line A. Nevertheless, despite his confusion and frustration, he still went along with it. Why? Because of the pressure to conform. Importantly, if even one other person in that group deviated from the norm of picking B, the participant too would feel freer to pick the correct answer. So one person can make a difference in this kind of situation. It can allow you to alleviate your concerns that pressure you to conform. So allies can fight conformity and actually serve as advocates by expressing your dissatisfaction with prejudiced behavior directly toward the perpetrator. This is some research by Margot Monteith and Leslie Ashburn-Nardo, and they have found that non-targets are actually more effective at confronting discrimination than are targets of discrimination. So if you're in a situation where you hear discrimination about women or an ethnic minority group, and you think, well, there's a woman here, maybe she'll respond, maybe she should be the one to do something about this. In fact, if she was the one to do it, it would be more likely that she would be seen as complaining, and it would also be more likely that the perpetrator would feel guilty. So because of those things, it can actually be more effective for an ally to confront that behavior directly. I also wanted to note that this may be particularly important, this confrontation may be particularly important for individuals who have invisible identities. What I mean by invisible identities are things that are not directly observable, they're not obvious, things like a gay or lesbian orientation, things like pregnancy at the early stages, a religious identity in some cases. These are stigmatized groups that may not want to out themselves. And in fact, by confronting prejudiced behavior, it may require a person to out themselves. So instead, if an ally speaks on their behalf, that might be the real way to help make change. So, in conclusion, I want you to take away three primary ideas. First, I want you to remember the gorillas, blind spots, and prostheses. I want you to remember that we are all subject to the effects of stereotypes and prejudice, and without our conscious awareness, we may contribute to and perpetuate the problems. I also want you to embrace the chocolate cake and individuate. Rather than trying to ignore the things that make us different, I want you to value your coworkers as individuals. Finally, I would ask that you please don't be afraid to draw your own line, to pick the right answer, to do the right thing, and to confront your own and others' biases. So I'd like to acknowledge a large set of fabulous co-authors, students, colleagues, as well as sponsors of this research, without whom none of this would be possible. I would also like to thank you for taking the time to spend your Monday evening with me. And at this time, I would welcome any questions that you have.